Brothers and sisters, ladies and gentlemen, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. It's my honor to present to you some of my thoughts and some of the research in regards to the concept of jinnah and possessions as we understand it. And as a young man growing up in a very spiritual tradition, the concepts of possessions and seeing some of those for the first hand and experiencing how they are dealt with in different ways. Essentially, I'd like to start with the whole concept of spirituality. Spirituality is something that means different things to different people. But essentially, spirituality to a Muslim starts with God, Allah. Because, as you will know, as Muslims and those who are believers, that it is believed that there is matter and there is spirit. And as matter is before us, spirit is not before us. We cannot see the spirit. Matter is constituent of what science tells us. Spirit is constituent primarily of what is told to us by belief systems. In scientific terms, there is no rational explanation of the spirit. But what scientists do accept is that matter does exist in its absolute forms, but its non-existence is unexplained, sometimes with cause of death not being known, cause of death being a mystery, and life and death is unexplained by scientific phenomena, scientific explanation, the beginning of life and the beginning of death. So in terms of the origins of life, we don't need to look at that today because we're not here on a scientific and faith exploration. But if you look at the origin of life itself, in the Prophet's terms, Prophet ﷺ said, that matter, which is tissue and some liquid, when it's germinated together, actually becomes a cell that replicates itself. But that tissue, which continues to replicate, otherwise which would be known as cancerous, because it replicates outside the norms of its surroundings, but because it's in a controlled way, it continues to duplicate itself to an extent where the Prophet ﷺ said, at 8 weeks, that matter, that tissue, something happens to that tissue. And he says, 1400 years ago, in that tissue is infused a spirit. And when that spirit is infused into that tissue, that is when that tissue actually takes independent life form. That's the explanation that the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, gave to us 1400 years ago. So the origins of the spirit into man, into matter, into life, is at 8 weeks when in gestation. As we understand it today, life actually starts when the heart beats and when it stops beating. And it's not coincidental that today, through scientific technology, we're able to discover that actually the heart starts beating at 8 weeks in gestation or thereabouts. That's the scientific calculation of the beat of the heart. So it seems to me, as a person of faith and somebody who understands science, that there is, it's not a coincidence that the explanation of faith as to the beginning of life, as in the infusion of the spirit, and the beating of the heart has a causal connection. Now, there's a whole ambit of discussion about the connection between the heart and the spirit, and I won't go into that just yet. I will touch upon that later on towards the end of the discussion. But essentially, this is the approach for a Muslim, an aware Muslim, of the connection between matter and spirit. And it is important to understand that, because when we're looking at phenomena which is beyond our cognitive perceptions, it is important to note that whilst we can dismiss some of these phenomena as we don't know, so it must not exist, it's fantasy, it's folklore, the reality is that there are phenomena, even as we understand science today and our rational minds understand life and death, there are phenomena that are beyond our comprehension, and spirit is one of them. So when some of the religious, if you like, narratives are presented, sometimes they're dismissed because these are religious narratives only for those that are keen to accept and eager to accept a religious narrative. But the reality is that it's not just stories or narratives that are told. These are, in my limited understanding, these are narratives that are beginning to be understood by our scientific discoveries today. But in explaining to you the origins of the jinn, which is and possessions, let me start with the story as it is told, the narrative as it starts in the Quran and Quranic teachings. In the first instance, Allah Almighty says that this world, this planet, was inhabited by jinns. Ibn Arabi, a famous scholar of 1,000 years ago, in his opinion, jinns, the first jinn, was created 60,000 years before the creation of Adam. This is his calculation. I'm not sure how many, which years he's talking about, life years or human years. But he says in his treatise, Futuhat al-Makkiyah, the Meccan revelations, that the first jinn was created 60,000 years before first man, Adam. The creation of the jinn was from from fire and air. The creation of man is from clay and water. So in their natural constituents, man is of different composition than that of the jinn. And in the Islamic teachings, where man is told to obey certain commands, the jinn is also told to obey certain commands. But in its origin, the jinn predates the creation of man. One of the most famous jinns that we are told about, and he's famous not just in the Islamic tradition, but he's famous in all religious traditions, is actually the famous jinn Iblis. You will know Iblis by the word devil, shaitan, Satan, you call him Lucifer. Different names are given to him, but actually, in the Islamic teachings, his origin is, his natural composition is, he is also a jinn. So he's made of fire and of air. And in the first instance, as we are told, this earth, this planet, was inhabited by the jinnah. And so Iblis, he was called, his first name was called Azazil. he was somebody, he was a phenomenon, he was in a life form in which he actually adulated God, worshipped God, and he was a devotee of God. In fact, it's also told that when the jinnat, who were inhabitants of this planet, went their own way and deviated, he was sent by God to correct those that were deviants, who were from the jinn communities. But you know the famous story, when man was created, the angels and all creation was asked to prostrate to man, and everybody did except Iblis, except Azazel. He said, no, I am of a superior constitution, and I will not bow down to that which is inferior, clay and water. And in material terms, if we look at man, whose constituent is water and clay, in the philosophical and the religious terms, you'd see that that which is air and fire would, on the face of it, would be of superior constitution. Those that are aware of the theory of photonics will say that the photon is of a superior constitution than anything that we know today. The spectrum of light is of a superior constitution than matter today. So in his resolution, he disobeyed God and he was banished, and we know the story from there. At some stage, we are told that the jinnan were then displaced from this earth to a parallel dimension, to another dimension, to another existence, another place, where they continue to exist even till today. Now, slightly hard to believe, but it is the way we are told. I was just reading up on some of the Muslim scientists, and they were giving their rational explanations, and I'd just like to read to you. When I was thinking about the jinnat living today in a parallel dimension, one of the Muslim scientists, his opinion is, and I'd like to read it to you, he says, on Earth, all life is made of carbon and water. Living things on Earth need energy for their activities. Some of these activities are chemical reactions which need a supply of energy. This supply of energy comes from the foods we eat, particularly the sugars. Fat is also a source of stored energy. When sugars are oxidized with oxygen, they are converted into water, carbon dioxide and energy. This is a process called respiration. Similarly, creatures elsewhere in the universe, such as the sun or stars, need energy. For those of the sun itself supplies the energy. He says, based on the laws of physics and chemistry, scientists argue the existence of creatures in the sun. The outermost part of the sun is called the chromosphere and corona. The temperature here is 4,000 degrees centigrade. Underneath the corona lies the photosphere, where the temperature is 5,700 degrees centigrade, which is the temperature on the surface of the sun. Inside the photosphere lies the plasma interior, and here the temperature is 30,000 degrees centigrade. At this temperature, the atoms lose their electrons, which wander freely. The density of the hot gases is equal to that of air at that surface of Earth. Halfway towards the center of the sun, the temperature rises to several million degrees centigrade. Probably a good place to have a suntan. Here, the electrons are completely removed from their atoms and move freely, leaving the atomic nuclei behind as positively charged ions. These separated positives and negatives move independently of each other, and this state of matter is called plasma. Plasma could be interpreted as the smokeless fire described in the Quran. At the center of the sun is the core, where the temperature reaches 10 million degrees and the density is 5 times greater than that of solid gold. That is the density of the core, which is greater than any material, matter, found on Earth. In the core, the nuclear fusion occurs, resulting in the fusion of hydrogen nuclei into helium nuclei plus liberation of energy, which we receive as the sunlight. He quotes Feinberg and Shapiro, scientists, who say, who predict that there is the highest probability of finding life in the plasma of our sun or any star. They call these creatures, and these two scientists, Shapiro and Feinberg, they call these creatures as plasma beasts. Plasma beasts can be construed as nothing but the jinns. And he explains that in chemical terms. Ibn Arabi, who I've read somewhat, of course, scientists say that, or these scientists believe that, in fact, these plasma beasts, who are smokeless, made of fire, actually live around the sun. Ibn Arabi, about 1100 years ago, he said, actually, these jinns live near Sagittarius. And you all know the compositions and the heat around Sagittarius. It's not for me to say that because of these assumptions, we must believe in this parallel dimension. But the reality is that we actually don't know much beyond our nose, scientifically. We are beginning to learn about our planet, our composition, and our reality. And the reality is beyond. The only thing I would submit to you is that as rational beings, it is irrational to deny something which we do not have knowledge of. It is irrational to simply dismiss them as folklore whilst we actually have not been at the core of the sun. And if somebody has, put your hand up and we'll listen to you, right? And I'll keep quiet. But the reality here is that here is a faith that offers explanations that are truly beyond our comprehension, but can start to make sense as we begin to investigate life and life forms outside of our planet. And in the absence of evidence, it is illogical and irrational to simply be dismissive. So, therefore, the conclusion of this part is that whilst as people of science and people of reason and logic, and somebody who wishes to question and lawyers question all the time, certain realities and certain narratives, it seems to me plausible to simply say that whilst there are explanations that have been consistent over a period of 1400 years, it is illogical to be simply dismissive of them and say they do not exist. The Quran has been very explicit in its explanation of the phenomenon of the jinn. Solomon of the Bible, Suleiman, Sayyidina Suleiman, alayhi salam, he is known to be a prophet who controlled and directed man and jinn. And I'll quote to you a famous story from the Quran in which Solomon in his temple was sat and addressing jinn and men, sat side by side. He said, Bilqis is about to come to me, and I'd like to actually welcome her by bringing her throne to my temple, to my palace. This is a story, a narrative in the Quran. And he said to those who were in his congregation, is there any one of you that can actually bring me this throne before she gets here? And in the story, a jinn puts up his hand and says, sir, dear Prophet Solomon, I'll bring the throne. Now it was told that this throne was actually carried by 5,000 people. It was such a huge and magnanimous throne that its weight was, I can't even guess if it's been carried by 5,000 people. So Solomon wanted to respect Bilqis in her arrival by bringing her throne to his palace. One of the jinns put his hand up and said, "I'll bring it for you." And Solomon asked, "How long will you take?" And he said, "Well, she's coming tomorrow. I'll have it here by the end of today." Solomon said, "Not good enough. A man who was said to be a servant of God, Ibadillah is the word, he put his hand up and he said, I will transport that throne from thousands of miles away to you before you can actually blink your eye. Not after you blinked your eye, but before you actually even blink your eye." Now, that story told 1400 years ago to a man that was riding on a donkey, at best on a horse, or on a camel if you had the Rolls Royce of the day. And you'd think a throne which is thousands and thousands of kilos to be transported thousands of miles by a man, could such man have powers? It would be impossible according to the logic and reason of man then. But today, when we see that we can actually transport matter through reflection, through fiber optic technology, through laser technology, and through forever changing technology, we can actually transport matter thousands of miles within split seconds. And of course, we're not actually transporting true matter. We're just beginning to learn to transport the reflection of matter through facts, through the World Wide Web. We're beginning to transport reflection of matter today, as we have been given the capacity to. So therefore, if what was inconceivable then through man's capacity is beginning to become possible and probable, then I would submit to you as rational beings, not just people of faith, but as rational beings, that we are moving towards the direction that we can actually start to transport matter as well. It will come. But people of faith have long believed that you can actually transport that matter, and those miracles are not just miracles, but they are actually rational narratives that we can plausibly start to believe in as logical human beings. So those are, and I can go on and on about some of the narratives that actually make a lot of sense. What we would call miracles actually make sense to me. But now is not the time and place, and I must move on to some of the key questions that you have in your mind today. We come across the phenomena of possessions. One must know that we are told there are good jinns and there are bad jinns. There are jinns that worship Allah, there are jinns that don't worship Him. There are jinns that deny Him. And jinns have the capacity to move from their dimension to our dimension. And also, they have the capacity to actually possess. Now, those of you that will know a little bit about science, and I know very little, but what little I know, you will know that matter, and intelligence in matter, is actually transported through neurons. Neurons are essentially pulses, light. So therefore, it is possible for light, for that which is a photonic base, to actually move within matter and exist within matter simultaneously. So therefore, when, as we say, spirit lives within the body and lives within the whole of the body, so we know that the phenomenon of spirit, which we cannot see, is also a light-based, and that's another topic for another day. But the reality is that it is possible and it is conceivable for that which is based on and made from the spectrum of light as its fire can actually exist simultaneously within that which is a human being and a person. So what you would perceive as possession as somebody who would actually become deformed and 10 foot tall and, you know, some of the imaginations of the authors of fiction, that's not true. Possessions can take place and the human being can retain their true matter. In terms of exorcisms, I'm not going to deal in great deal about exorcisms, but the reality is that there are many exorcists who are would-be and learner exorcists, but the reality is that when this phenomena actually happens, it has to be treated with a great deal of care. I have seen somebody, and I can't understand with a rational mind how it could happen, where somebody who was presented to me, actually, who was said to be possessed over a period of time, I saw, there was about 10 people with me, that their nose was actually pulled and was found at their ear place because they were possessed. So that jinn has the power to actually manipulate matter and has the power to manipulate it to such an extent that actually it can become quite horrible looking. Obviously, I did the most logical thing. I ran. But no, I try to help in the best way I could. And I'm not a specialist exorcist, but there are traditions through which true exorcism happens. And all the people that I see advertised in newspapers and other journals, I take them with a pinch of salt, because true exorcists won't really advertise themselves, because this is serious business. And it is also true that these stories actually play on people's minds, and people do actually fake things. I remember the story of a very wise man that I came across, and I asked him about exorcism and how he used to deal with it. And he said to me that 99 out of 100 cases of possessions are actually fakes. There are people who are seeking attention. And he told me a nice story about this old lady that he went to visit. And she was speaking in a man's voice, and she was jumping on walls and doing all sorts of acrobatic things. Somebody that would actually get a place in a circus and would make a lot of money from it. But he said, I saw her and I prayed and I realized that this lady's actually faking it. I explained to her, because her four sons had brought me to her and said, look, our mom's ill, she's possessed and she speaks funny, she does funny things, she climbs on walls and does all sorts of Spider-Man tricks. So would you be able to help my mom? So what he did, he asked her to, he asked his sons to leave, and he spoke to her in confidence and said, look, you know, I'm no novice to this. I know what's going on. You're actually faking it. And at which point she realized that she has to react to him. So she started a whole man's voice and her running on walls and all of those tricks that she had learned. So he realized that this, what the problem was here, because he had understood the constitution of the family a little bit. So he told me what he did was, he said, I'm now going to exorcise this jinn. So he said to the sons, what I want you to do, because before he announced this, he said to the lady, look, I know you're faking it, but I'm going to do something to you that's really going to hurt you. So unless you don't stop faking things and let's start talking sense, you're going to get hurt. But she didn't listen. She dismissed his threat. So this wise man, he told his those four sons, he said, now I want you to hold your mother down. Two of you hold her hands and two her feet. And I want you to bring me a knife, because I'm going to exorcise this jinn by cutting her foot off. Now, she was hearing all of this, and she thought he was bluffing. So sure enough, they held her down, and he got a knife and big massive machete. And he says, now, I'm going to exorcise this jinn, and I'm going to take him out of you. I'm going to chop your foot off. At which point she screamed and she said, time out. So he asked the sons to leave, and he said, look, I know what your problem is. You're actually a lonely woman. You're actually bored. And you just want your sons to spend time with you, isn't it? And she cried and wept and wailed, and she said, you're right. I actually want my sons to spend time with me, and because I put on this act, they actually do spend time with me. So this wise man said, actually, I've got a solution for you. So he brought the sons in and he said, I have now finally exorcised the jinn from your mother, keeping the veil on her little act that she had done. And he said, but the jinn has said that if he finds this woman alone, he's going to possess her. So you, Mr. Sons, each one of you has to spend 2-3 hours a day with your mum. And if you don't, this jinn's going to come back. And of course, the son said, of course we'll spend time with our mum. So we had a happy mum, happy family, and no exorcism. That's the kind of stories that I think are more common, where people are actually hiding behind other matters. I didn't realize that at the time. I'll try and move on. In fact, the reality is that the kind of position that I've come from, there's so many phenomena that I can explain to you. I can be stood here all day explaining some of the things that I've seen, some which are funny and some which are real and actually quite breathtaking. But the reality is that there are two things here. One is true possession, which, in fact, if a jinn, as we are told in the Quranic narrative, if he transgresses and actually possesses somebody, they're breaking a law, and they will be reprimanded. And as we have governance, the jinns have governance too. So the idea for possession only happens in 1 in a million circumstances. But what is the reality of certain deviances and thought processes that go wrong in man? You see, we know that there's a good side and there's a dark side. Dark side, which is fed by jealousy, anger, venom, hatred, prejudice. We know that there's a dark side. But what is it that we are explained through religious phenomena as the protagonist of that dark side? Because quite clearly, something has to be fed from somewhere. We're not born evil. We are born good. We're not taught evil, because the little baby isn't born with evil. But the reality is that is explained to us through the story that I mentioned to you earlier on. When Iblis, as Azim, when he was excommunicated and sent out of heaven, he looked at God and he said, you did it, and I served you for thousands of years, but you did it because of this man. And he challenged God, and that challenge, those words are contained in the Quran. In the holy book, he says, لَأُغْذِيَنَّهُمْ أَجْمَعِينَ. I'm going to misguide each and every one of them. I'm going to make sure that they all deviate from your path. Illa ibadaka minhum al-mukhlasin, except those who are sincere. Now, in explaining that, there are many verses of the Quran that actually tell us how he misguides us. The idea that Satan, the devil, is some kind of a creature with horns and with a tail is actually, I mean, he'll be looking at this and laughing at it, because there's no such a description in the holy books. But what he does do is that he whispers. And now if you think about your thought processes, we all have thought processes going through our mind day and night. And what he's able to do, what he has the capacity to do, is to whisper into man's ear. Now, he doesn't physically whisper, you don't hear voices. But some of those thought processes that are energized, and those dark, the side which is energized, is actually energized through his whispers. And that's what we talked about. It's explained in Surah An-Nas. قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ النَّاسِ مَلِكِ النَّاسِ إِلَهِ النَّاسِ مِنْ شَرِّ الْوَسْوَاسِ الْخَنَّاسِ. He's the one who puts the waswasa, the point of descent inside man, مِنْ الْجِنَّةِ وَالنَّاسِ, from the jinn and from man. So, some people are more acute to that and more sensitive to that. So, people will say, well, they suffer from hallucinations. From their imagination, they see things which are fed from the dark side. That is probably because they are more acute and more sensitive to that. But the reality is that each one of us is fed with those whispers, and our thought processes are energized through those whispers. And if any one of you said that you actually are not energized and you don't have any thoughts which are from the dark side, jealousy, envy, hatred, put your hand up and we'll give you the best award in the universe, because you won't be a human being, you'll actually be an angel, right? But it is the reality for each one of us that we hear these whispers, silently or otherwise, and they feed our dark side. So that is one aspect of it. Second aspect of it is, the first aspect is the jinn, the second aspect is the whispers from shaitan, and the third aspect is witchcraft. Witchcraft, again, is such a long topic that I could be stood here all day talking about some of the witchcraft that I've come across and some of the evil that they perpetrate. But did you know that there are actually, in this country, registered witches? Now, I know we glorify witchcraft through Harry Potter and through Narnia and through The Wizard of Oz and other folklore and entertainment stories, but the reality is that there are registered witches in this country. There are registered wizards in this country. So people who practice those arts are actually found in this country, in Pakistan, Bangladesh, India, and in all the countries. In Africa, you have voodoo people. In China, you have similar people who actually practice witchcraft and the black arts. What is the composition of that? Again, I could be stood here all day talking about what they feed on, but quite clearly they feed on a dark side and the dark arts and some of the routines that they have learned through satanic practices. But the reality is that they do affect, and this is my honest opinion from what I've seen, and probably in my few years of living within the community and helping people in the community, there are more people that are affected by witchcraft than there are affected by possessions. Because that is a true phenomenon, that does exist. How that affects, again, again, will be a long discussion. But there's a third phenomenon, which is bad luck, what we call nazar. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that the envy of a person actually materially affects the next person. So what we say, evil eye, actually is nazar. Somebody who looks through the eyes of darkness at the next person, that actually transcends some of that evil, some of that darkness upon that person. And I've seen more of that in the community. But the reality is that 85% of the people I see in surgery, in spiritual surgery, 85% of the people are actually not affected by anything. Not by nazar, not by witchcraft, not by possessions. They are actually possessed by something which is even more global. And that's our humanity. The way we are today. The truth is, we are a failing humanity. We are suffering from depression and from all those diseases that you people in the healthcare industry are charged with. What is that fueled by? That's fueled by all the social diseases that you can think of. Breakdown of the family unit, breakdown of the social unit, breakdown of the neighborhood, breakdown of the community. The reality is that systematically we have dismantled the anchors of social cohesion, of social rest. Systematically, as we've progressed materially, we have broken down and dismantled those institutions which actually harbor the mental health of the humanity. Now, the church was a very good example of that. But with the failing church, people suffered. Their mental health suffered. The family unit was a good example of that. But the breakdown of the family unit meant that those people suffered. So the breakdown of relationships, the breakdown of institutions like marriage, where partnership is now deemed to be actually a commercial transaction, a marriage of convenience. We'll live together because, I live with her, not with her, I live with him, not with him, because we can buy a better home, because she earns more or she earns less. So today, we are actually constructed and guided by certain material concepts rather than true human concepts. And 85% of the people that come to me actually are the victims of that phenomenon, which we are all responsible for. They actually suffer from that, and they will say to me, please pray for me because the reality is that somebody's done witchcraft, or so-and-so did this, and so-and-so did nazar. The reality is that society has failed them. I'm going to introduce to you a phenomena by concluding with that phenomena. The phenomenon in the Islamic tradition which upholds that mental health is something that's called tariqah. You have Sharia, the laws and principles which govern matter, but in the Islamic tradition you have tariqah, the spiritual path which govern spiritual health. And that is something that's fueled my excitement as I've grown up in this community, in England, coming here as a young boy of five, I've actually learned those principles of the spiritual way, and I have realized that actually that is the fodder, that is the energy that we need to actually bring to the community. Now I know that there are pseudo-spiritualists, healers, that actually seek to fill that gap. But again, based on an ideology or a phenomena that is not tried and tested, is actually stepping into dangerous water. I say that from the 1400 years tradition of tariqah, the spiritual lineage that has been established in Islam, I see great fortitude, and that is the fortitude with which we are seeking to enrich the community that I come across, Muslim and non-Muslim. That is the answer that I have, and I feel that those people that are charged with that, those people that have come across that, they have truly benefited, not just intellectually or through their logical perceptions, but also emotionally as well, and both things walk side by side. Now the truth is that I've actually skipped through a lot of what I could say and what I'd like to say in order to really elaborate on some of the key issues that I've touched upon. But time is upon us, and forgive me if I skim through some aspects of it, but I will be available for questions later on. Thank you very much.